we were shooting a scene with Bill hitting LG with a hammer. And Dobie did like 17 or 20 takes on that. Going again, see it again. And Bill was worried if he hadn't been doing anything right. I was having a good time, Bill. He liked making his movies. So that's the audition experience.
Now, are you a horror fan yourself?
A fan? Well, not a genre necessarily. I like a well-made movie. And sometimes they're a horror film, and sometimes they're comedy or, you know, action adventure. Typically, my horror background in films was more of a cautionary tale told to us like by Edgar Allan Poe and others. But there were lessons to be learned, and then it got different. It became sort of like a torture porn eventually.
Yeah.
So I think it's shifting. Hopefully, get back to a good, decent bloodletting. Some perhaps conversation. Yeah, conversation. Like Caroline said, you know, to Bubba, I don't think this is going to work out. Perfect. Kid Carson cooked up a great script for us. And he kept rewriting every day. He would be sitting at the tiny typewriter, portable mechanical typewriter, and he'd be right by the entrance typing up new words and giving them to people to see if we quote it. Jim Cena's speech about, then came the shame. He got that just before he went in to shoot, and he learned it fairly quickly. And just tore it. You know, when you're doing that, it's just not that different than any other kind of job you do. You have to get used to the routine. But it's more like surgery. You gotta do it right the first time if you can.
So, obviously, I mean, this was a very long time ago, and you've had so much more experience since then. Is there any advice you would give, like, pre-Texas Chainsaw?
I I typically, when I go to an audition, I don't try to have anything particular in mind, just to be open to whatever it is they're going to bring. Because usually they want you to come up with something new, because they thought of everything already and they want to be refreshed and just see what you can bring to the screen. I did look at some of the script and I saw, black humor, okay, I like that. And so I had to fit that in. Aaron Toby would, Toby directed from off camera. Not a lot of directors will do that. Mostly the actors hate it, right? However, I was trained by someone who insisted on telling me how to do it. And so I was grateful because I didn't have to try to read his mind, he just told me. Because that's what I think of an actor. I, and myself, like, what's in your mind, director, so I can blend in there with it and we can synergize something really great. And not all directors are good at that. Mostly they're photographers, often are writers, but they don't have much experience in working with actors, assisting them to reveal what they have buried up in cage. So, there's that.
Yeah, especially in film, I guess, because you don't have time to get everything done. Especially for a lower budget film, you have to get everything done so fast you don't have the time to really dig into the site.
For a lower budget film, you don't have the time, the luxury of time that you would on a higher budget film to dig into psyche of a character, is that correct?
Oh yeah, right.
Yeah,
Cannon was, they were in a hurry. Toby had gone 20 weeks over on the previous movie. That's like two extra movies.
Yes.
So, they were anxious about this one. And they put a lot of, they brought people up from L.A. and limousine comes up and walks out and screamed. Okay, you're on schedule now. Get going.
Oh. Do we have any other questions? Yes.
What was your favorite moment after?
My favorite moment is Leatherface. I guess there were two. One was the ironic humor of this cannibal family. And at the dinner scene, the world member is just loaded with barbecue and sauce, and they're all looking at bugs and crawdads and stuff. The rats would come out and eat the crawfish immediately. And they just scarf them on top. So they eventually had to tie the rats to this black thread, and they kept all the crawfish outside of that radius. I thought, man, those rats, they just sat back. I could see them smile. They were eating it like pouring the coffee. Weird sound. And there was two or three rats making that noise. It was just fascinating. I think Dennis kind of smirked at that too. But my first, I guess most memorable would be with Caroline in the great group where the clock always said 6 o'clock. So Toby talked me through that one because I couldn't come up with what he came up with. Show this.
What was it like working with Dennis
Holland? Working with Dennis, I didn't see him much. He would come to the set when he was shooting, and then he would not be around. He would be over at Willie Nelson's golfing. Where else they do it? was, you know, focused and intent, good humor, like to have fun, but, you know, and he was always ready. He knew the line perfectly, even New York's. And his, you know how, like, if you have a really strong magnet and you move it around things that are magnetic, it'll move them around even though it's not touched. He was like that. He had a tremendously strong focus and personality, and his expertise as a performer just kind of oozed out of him, and I'm picking that up and going with it. Everyone else. Who's next? Okay.
I have a follow up of Dennis Hopper question. Did he teach you anything important on the set? About acting and movie making or anything?
Well, he didn't, you know, like, instruct me. It's right. Just stuff I picked up.
What was that you learned through observation?
I think it was that I was trying to copy how relaxed he was. Because he was highly concentrated, very relaxed, which is a bit difficult to do. And mostly he was coaching Caroline. And he really added tremendously to Caroline's knowledge base, her performance, and took the film up another notch or two, because that's a tough role for a girl, female, any, you know, anybody, but, you know, for the heroine to kind of, you know, take over, to take in things over and conquer. Sequels built right into that.
Any others out there? I know you got it, don't be shy. No? Oh, there we are.
One of my favorite scenes is when you have to put the face on her to keep her hidden. I was just wondering how, if you could talk a bit about, like, approach that scene or how you work together on that scene.
That scene was in the, I think, called the ballroom, the smokehouse. And at that time, probably 3-4 days before that, I came down with the worst case of pneumonia the doctor had ever seen. I didn't find out till years, decades or two later, at a Fango show in LA, where Toby, that was like Toby had never been before or since, to a chainsaw show, convention. God, I just had a brain. Would you repeat your question?
I just, how you approached that scene and the ridiculousness.
Oh, that, yeah, okay. So I was out, and Toby told me that I had caught the flu from Bob. Bob Elmore, because Bob Elmore's stunt mask was stolen. So they used mine for him. Apparently they didn't cleanse it because I was out for a week, and Bob, they put Bob in that as the performer in that, where I would have been doing it. My guess is that they would have been waiting for me to come back if they didn't have such a bad time crunch. My thoughts are is that Toby was coaching from off camera, because there was a lot going on that looked like actor know-how, and that had to come from the director. Bob himself said he's no actor, and there was, you know, a lot of big moves coming up. So, but Bob had a tremendously acute physical sense, and Caroline said he's super vicious. His attack was very vicious, and something that was one of his stronger points. If you ever watch John Candy in, was it Summer?
Summer
Rental, I think that's it. And Bob was stuck double friggin', and Bob had jumped through a window from outside into a room, did a somersault into a crouch, and with his head down, he spun around and dropped into an easy chair. That was pretty great. That was pretty great. Yeah, we would have conversations about the character, and he asked me about Bill, you know, kiss Caroline. So yeah, Judas Iscariot, and he grabbed my shoulders. He said, "Thank you." He had a great sense of it. Excellent actor, running on empty. And he did some other roles, but I didn't have heard from that. He was very soulful, thoughtful, nice vocabulary, and he had a sense of dialect. He and Toby came up with a lot of stuff during the language during the film, trying to find something that would be a good tweak for that moment.
Back there.
And you might have the same thoughts on the marketing photo shoot for the movie poster, the Breakfast Club, the movie poster, which was there. It's for you, President.
Can you stop real loud?
Yeah. It's not just for you, President. Do you have any thoughts about the marketing photo shoot?
Oh, the Breakfast Club?
Yeah.
That was Kit's idea. We had done a number of different poses, but he came up with that. Everybody seemed to go with it. They seemed to like it pretty good. It was a fun one to do.
Kind of set the tone for the film, too.
Again?
Kind of set the tone, too, when he went inside. He knew it wasn't going to be like original.
Right, yeah, we were up and coming yuppies. If you can't get them, eat them. A lot of nutrients, they made a lot of money for that.
And Brenda, please.
In the music district of Austin when punk was was at a really high pitch. Clubfoot was just insane, and there was a lot of things going on downtown. It's kind of hard to get a copy of that film nowadays. It's pretty weird. It's been there for a while.
We have time for one more. Right there.
Did I what?
The Austin punk rock band, the Dicks.
I don't recall.
Who gives you
the Dicks? Let's see. I worked with the lead singer of the Bible Surfers. At a restaurant. And the Buffalo Gals. But they weren't really punk. But they were a hell of a girl band.
Sure. 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 The microphone on the chair behind you.